I'm Brian DeFelice from the Thomas Green Public Library, and I'm joined today by Jim O'Connell, who's here to talk about his book and upcoming program at the library entitled Dining Out in Boston, A Culinary History, which will be held on Tuesday, February 7th at 7 p.m. Jim, thank you so much for coming into the studio today and having a chat with me.
Nice to be here, Brian.
So tell me a little bit about yourself. How did you become a writer, and what's some of your history?
Well, I'm a trained historian, but I'm also a city planner, and I've always been interested in writing about cities I've lived in. And I've really been interested in Boston. This is my second book on Boston. Earlier one was on the development of metropolitan Boston, and this is on the history of Boston restaurants. But I think it goes way beyond Boston. Anybody who's interested in restaurants in general in America would be interested in this story, because Boston and New York are probably the two places in this country that really invent restaurants. Mm. So there's a lot going on in Boston 200 years ago, in fact.
Yeah. So you've written quite a few books, that's correct? This is not your first time.
Six books, yeah.
So tell me a little bit about the upcoming program. What can people expect?
Well, I will. The real key to this book is showing historic menus, going back 200 years.
Wow.
And it really, the book and the presentation really let people see what dining would have been like 100 years ago, 150, 200 years ago even, and what the meals would have been like. And it really kind of engages people to think how dining has evolved, but including menus from 20 or 40 years, 60 years ago as well, which people would remember on their own.
Yeah. What are some of the notable differences that you noticed between back then and now?
In the 19th century, it was really amazing. If you were all middle class or upper class, they had incredible banquets, the likes of which we just do not have today. 10-course banquets, game was really big, lots of game birds. It was really a period of real indulgence, if you will. And you recall the pictures of the men, these big, heavyweight, overweight men, mm-hmm. and it's because they were having these incredible banquets. Wow. And in the 20th century, particularly now the 21st, mm-hmm. we've become much more conscious of diet and eat more streamlined meals.
Right. How did immigration affect the culinary evolution of Boston?
The first restaurant in America was actually in Boston, wow. with a French chef escaping from the French Revolution and the Reign of Terror,
wow.
to come to Boston in 1793. And his name was Julien's restaurant, which was the first kind of French-style restaurant where you could go in, look at the menu, and order specific dishes. Before that, you went into an inn, and they said, we're having stew tonight, and that was it. So that introduced it early on. But then it was really more around 1900 when you had Chinese restaurants starting, Italian restaurants mm-hmm. coming in, maybe some Greek, German restaurants maybe a little earlier. So around the turn of the 19th to 20th century, that's when you really start to see ethnic restaurants as we know them more today.
Yeah. So how did you go about researching for this book?
Well, this was the key. I discovered at the Bostonian Society, a library, an incredible menu collection a number of years back, mm-hmm. where they had hundreds of menus going back to the 1820s. And the oldest known menu in America dates back to 1824, when the Marquis de Lafayette came to Boston. Mm-hmm. And that's, you look at this collection of menus and you say, there's a real story here. So that's what I started. I said, tell the story of these menus and you'll get a great story. And that's what I've done.
Yeah. So have any of these restaurants that are mentioned in your book, do they still exist today?
Well, it's a mix. I start the book off with kind of a joke. This is a guidebook to restaurants which mostly no longer exist, because I'm trying to tell the whole story of restaurants going
right.
back to the 1790s. But the oldest operating restaurant in America is the Union Oyster House, 1826. Durgan Park was founded a year later. So mm-hmm. these are the two oldest operating restaurants in America. So you have things like that. And, you know, the Parker House, which people may not realize, that goes back to 1855. And that was the first hotel to offer an a la carte menu. Again,
wow.
where you could go in and just order what you wanted instead of going in and having all these dishes put before you.
Yeah. Were there any other key establishments that you mentioned in the book that sort of contributed to the evolution of Boston?
Well, kind of in the 19th century, most of the good restaurants were hotels. And that was kind of the case maybe up until the 1950s. And then it began to really change with hotel restaurants. You still have decent hotel restaurants, but weren't the main place to eat. But in the 50s and 60s, you get the great seafood restaurants, Jimmy's Harborside, Anthony's Pier 4, which really started a whole new style of dining. So those are important restaurants. And Anthony's, although the main one is closed in the South Boston waterfront, there still are branches on Cape Cod and the North Shore.
Yeah. How do you think that Boston's culinary past is affecting the present culinary situation in the future?
Boston, for many, definitely in the 19th century, was very much into innovation. Its innovations in the early part of the 20th century kind of became more conservative, if you will, more of a stand pat situation. But since the 1970s, Boston has been a real champion of all kinds of ethnic cooking and innovative cooking. So it's competitive with any city in the country, I think, over the last 30 or 40 years. Mm. It was a bit stodgy maybe in the 50s and 60s, but it's moved beyond that.
Why do you think it sort of stalled in the 50s and 60s? Was there a specific reason for that?
That was the situation everywhere in America. The food was kind of plain, if you will. Mm-hmm. But the interesting thing is this. If you look at the early 20th century, we kind of moved away from these fancier banquets and kind of French dishes and went back to rediscover the Yankee favorites. Mm. You know, for instance, in the 19th century, they would have just called it baked beans or boiled dinner. In the 20th century, they call it Boston baked beans, New England boiled dinner. And then they begin to have these restaurants which specialize in that.
They're branding it.
So branding it, whereas it was just kind of nothing special earlier on. So then we celebrate that from the 20s maybe through the 60s. Mm-hmm. Those are the best restaurants. It's, you know, the Wayside Inn in Sudbury or the Public House in Sturbridge or other places like that that are specializing in, you know, New England clam chowder or Boston cream pie.
Yeah. What would you like people to take away from both the program and the book?
Oh, take away that Boston has a dynamic history which still lives with us. And I really loved your question, how much of this history is still with us? How much of these traditions? One of the great ones is sweets and ice creams. Mm. Boston was a capital of ice cream going back to the 19th century and still remains one of the great ice cream cities in America. It's funny, the best ice cream tends to be in colder cities than in warmer cities. For some reason, we really treasure it. A lot of it has to do with a sweet tooth, because going back to colonial days, Boston traded with the Caribbean and the Sugar Islands, brought on the molasses. They created the rum here from the molasses, but also all these candy companies. Tootsie Rolls are still made here. Necco Wafers. The Schraff's Candy Factory, they don't make candy there anymore, but that was where they made Schraff's candy. So Boston has always been a great center for sweets and ice cream. And Howard Johnson's, where does that come from? Comes right down the block
right
here
down
in
the
Quincy.
Block, yep.
And that invented the modern ice cream, you know, with 28 flavors. Before Howard Johnson came along, it was, you know, vanilla, chocolate, and strawberry. Hmm. And then he said, wait a minute, we can have 28 flavors. Really, they had a lot more than 28.
Is there anything that you'd like to add before we conclude?
Well, I do talk in my book about the 21st century, 21st century dining, and how that has evolved. I don't get into that so much in my presentations. But as I said, we have a very, food is in a very dynamic phase. Restaurants are opening all the time. Everybody's interested in them. Everybody's sharing notes about what's the latest place to go or the best place to go. So it's a really interesting time to engage people to think about what we eat and how we eat.
It's Jim O'Connell, and he'll be doing a presentation at the library entitled Dining Out in Boston, A Culinary History, on Tuesday, February 7th at 7 p.m. Thank you so much for coming in.
Well, thank you, Brian.
If you'd like more information about this program or any program at the library, please visit our website at thomasgreenlibrary.org.